Hello.
Hello.
I'm Jake.
I'm Rory.
And we are LDS. And this is, we haven't got a name for it yet, have we?
Well, yeah, not sure yet. But Movers One is one idea.
Yes, Movers One. It kind of encapsulates some of the ethos of what we're about when we play in clubs, when we DJ. But yeah, we've decided to do a radio / podcasty type thing. It's basically a radio show, but we're pre-recording it and uploading it to lots of platforms. We've been going for 12 years, and we're in the year 2023. We've been going for 12 years.
Not long now.
Yep. It's currently the very end of December, so we're recording the January show, and we're going to do 12 episodes, one a month, throughout 2023. So that's 12 episodes for the 12 years we've been going. It's very self-explanatory. Pre-recorded radio show podcast. It should be on all platforms. We're going to put the video on YouTube, and we're going to put the audio on all of the, you know, Spotify, Apple podcasts, everywhere we can, and also on our SoundCloud. It's not a DJ mix, because we've got loads of DJ mixes, haven't we?
Yeah, we have. So I think the format was going to have a bit of a chat.
That's right.
Kind of open format, not really anything.
No plan
goes
at all.
we're going to wing it. We're going to have a little chat, play some tunes, and yeah, we're looking forward to seeing what comes out, really.
Yeah, it's going to be enjoyable. You've got a record ready, haven't you?
I have, so should we kick off with that?
Yeah, let's go for it. Tell me what it's called.
So yeah, this record is one actually I picked up in a record store last week, but it was a total flashback, because it was like when I first started getting into disco music. It was I can't remember which YouTube channel it was, but it was one of those. I think there's like Slaved 5000 or Cool Funk was another one. I was like really digging these records on the internet through YouTube. And I stumbled across this one the other day, and it just sort of brought back all those memories of like those early days of when we started doing our thing together.
Yeah.
So the track is called Get It On, and it's by Spence.
Get It On by Spence. Let's hear it.
We'll be right back.
Well, that was lovely.
Yeah, not bad, huh? Yeah, I'm quite happy to be reminded of that tune and reunited with it, because you know, there was quite a few years that I was rinsing that, and then it kind of went away. That's the beautiful thing about digging from records, I think, is that, you know, it can bring back part of your past, or, you know, it's like a, yeah.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, like, I wanted to say something about the whole thing with, like, finding music on YouTube, because that you were saying that was originally something that you found years ago when you were first getting into disco on a YouTube channel. And one of the things that, for me, when I first got into disco and decided that I wanted to try and form LDS, there was a YouTube channel that I was listening to. It was, I think it was called Carbon Disco. And it was like, it was basically, there was a club night in Manchester that used to put disco tunes on a YouTube channel with like their logo over it. Mm. And I discovered loads of those when I was just digging for other music, digging on YouTube.
And, yeah, it's funny.
That's the way things are. But yeah, Carbon Disco, I think it was called. It was like a Manchester club night. That was one of the things that inspired the start of LDS, because it was one of the things that got me really listening to like deeper disco and like disco edits, and realizing that it wasn't just the cheesy pop music from the 70s.
I think there's something to be said for that, though, because it's sort of it's come full circle now. That, like, I've actually found that tune ages ago on a website, and now I've actually got the physical copy of it. So it's...
Yeah, no, definitely.
It feels good.
Yeah. Right, so next tune, actually, talking about sort of the origins of stuff, it's Sol Makossa by Manu Dibango. Lots of people know in the sort of history of disco that this tune was the first tune that, well, one of the first tunes that was really made big by a DJ playing it. So David Mancuso in the Loft in the 70s was playing this a lot, and then all the other DJs wanted to play it. And it sold big time, even though it wasn't getting any radio play. And that made record labels realize that DJs really had the power to make tunes big. And that's, you know, I've been learning a lot about that from, I listened to the audiobook of Last Night DJ Saved My Life. And that's a great
one.
Well,
I haven't listened to it, but I've read it. I've got the, but I actually want to get the new version of it, because they put a load more stuff in there. But if anyone out there hasn't read that and wants to understand the history of music, it is unbelievable.
Yeah, it's really a brilliant, unbelievable. Brilliant book. Is the new version that I listened to. I think it talks about this in there. Also, Tim Lawrence and Jeremy Gilbert on their podcast, Love is the Message, I've been listening to that, and they talk a lot about the history of DJing and music, and they talk about this tune. And I played this tune as my first tune when I opened up at my set at Shambhala Festival in 2022. This is the first tune I played because I thought it was significant to let people know that disco runs deeper than just the pop music they may know. So
should we get into it? We'll be right back.
Anumuna, Sisiao, Yasa Makosa. Amuna yeye, Amuna yeye, Kuma, Samakosa. Tanga tanga, umbusa tanga, Nesa Makosa. Nika so.
So that was, of course, Sol Makossa by Manu Dibango. And yeah, it's funny, I was saying that that was one of the tunes that helped start disco as a sound, just because it made record labels pay attention. And then there was this back and forth between DJs and record labels, and this sound designed for people to dance for to was developed, now known as disco. Yeah, it's funny though, because you were talking about...
What year was that then? What year
was I think it was like 73,
yeah, so yeah. Pretty early on.
Yeah. But yeah, it's funny because, you know, you were saying about finding music on YouTube before. Genres historically have often developed out of little pockets of culture in specific locations, but now with the internet, they're kind of, they can develop anywhere, and you have like things that pop up suddenly and they become like a global sound very quickly. I've noticed that recently with a few different sounds. There's a lot of music coming out of Africa at the moment, actually, like the sort of, you know, the modern Afrobeat, which is just getting sucked up everywhere. Everyone's into it, and the sort of the rhythms, they've just like clocked onto it and started making it in everything, in like pop music. So it's cool to see how the internet can spread these sounds so quickly.
Information travels faster these days
exactly.
than waiting to get a record pressed and then handing it out to DJs and clubs to get a reaction and all of that.
Exactly. That whole process probably took years, and now like you can just put a tune on the internet and suddenly you've created something and everyone knows about
it. All the statistics and the analytics of who's listening where. It wasn't like that back then, was it?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. But yeah, that record there was, you know, it laid the pathway for all of that. So it's quite an important record. So what have you got next, Rory?
So next record I've got is actually one that I picked up in India a few years back, which, you know, was quite a funny story. Went out there to play a gig that got cancelled, so it was sort of like a DJ's holiday. We were at a festival in Goa that didn't happen.
Sounds great.
So then I actually I went on and did a little mini tour after that. Went to Delhi, Mumbai, Bangalore, played some gigs there. But whilst I was in Delhi, I hit up some record shops, and this one was a funny one, because just the process of trying to find this record shop, it was in the middle of like this bazaar, which had all kinds of other stuff going on. It was like metal work, you know, butchers, all kinds of stuff. Not a very unlikely spot to find a record shop. But anyway, yeah, I eventually got there and it was like a treasure trove. So I think this one was from Shah's, but I got a couple from New Gramophone as well. And we were just talking about this record before, because it's clearly got a few influences going on there, but in a sort of Bolly disco style, I guess.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. And we've historically been into that as well. Like sort of, you know, disco sounds from all over the world, not just straight out of New York. I think like we also said we're talking a lot about disco, but what's important to remember is the way that disco started as a genre. That last tune, for example, was very much like a sort of high life Afrobeat type tune. Disco started from people playing all sorts of genres from all over the world, and that just became sort of homogenized into this disco sound. But originally it was just about playing anything that sounded good to dance to.
Yeah, so this one is actually from a soundtrack, unsurprisingly, if it's come out of India. A lot of great music came on, like accompanied a film. So this one is from a film called Guru, which I haven't actually seen, to be honest. But, you know, the record sleeve, the record sleeve itself has some fantastic pictures on it. That's brilliant. Yeah. So this track is called I Am a Bad Girl.
Oh, yeah. I know this one.
All right. Shall we play it?
Yeah, go for it.
ना जाने दोनों का क्या होगा
That was Bad Girl, right?
I am a bad girl.
I am a bad girl.
Yeah, of course you are.
Oh, he got me there. I was saying to you before that it kind of reminded me a bit of like the style of Madonna's music in that era as well. Because I've got an album of covers of Madonna in like Hindi.
Oh, have you?
Yeah. And it sounds very similar to that. That was kind of the in thing.
It's a bit of a mixture. I'm definitely getting sort of Billie Jean influences in the production.
Yeah.
That dink, dink,
that
little
definitely.
Thing. It's a great record. It's one that I treasure a lot. I mean, I don't play it that often, but it's just one that I have in my collection. The artwork I love to look at, and I love that tune. There's some other wicked tunes on there as well, but
you were saying also that you like the sort of rough like product, and it got a bit crackly at the end there. That's probably a bit of dust, but like the rough sound of the production and the mastering.
Yeah, I do. Like, it's sort of slightly out of balance. Like, you know, the sort of percussion that comes in is a little bit too high, and the rest of the vocals are pretty rough, and I kind of like that. It adds to the charm of...
Feels real, doesn't it?
It feels real. It feels like, it feels like a real piece of music. That's not too polished. You know, everything is nowadays with a lot of, especially digital files, or even just mastering the way that people do it now. It's you if you look at the file, the waveform, you just see this, you know, this sort of square, solid line. And I think, you know, it takes away some of the character.
I agree. Something I've been thinking about a lot also is so some audiophiles will say that the most accurate reproduction of sound is a lossless digital, like a CD, or, you know, like a really high quality WAV, which is probably correct when you think about it in terms of like laboratory settings and creating the most accurate reproduction. But the reason people enjoy vinyl is not because of its accuracy, it's just because it sounds nice. And it's very similar to making films and video. People spend a lot of time and effort trying to make digital video look like film because they like the imperfections in the film. They like the grain of the film, and that's kind of like the grain of the sound, which sounds really nice.
Yeah, I like a little crackle. I mean, maybe there was a little bit too much of a crackle on that one, but I don't mind the crackle on an old vinyl. I quite like it. Again, it adds to the character, I think.
Yeah, for sure.
Piece of music and the history of that particular record.
That's it. And so next up, I'm going to play, it's the dub mix of Colonel Abrams' Music is the Answer. Now, Colonel Abrams was a bit of a pop star. It's not much of a digger's tune, I wouldn't say, but it was produced by Yvonne Turner. Let me just double check that I've got her name right. But yeah, I read an article about it recently, and it's kind of like a proto house tune. So it's you know, it's kind of the post disco sound that was going on in the 80s. And it's talking about, you know, music in terms of a tool to bring people together and enrich people's lives, which I think is an important message. But yeah, it's produced by Yvonne Turner, who was ignored on sort of like the sleeve notes, I think, for some reason. But she was a female producer and basically one of the inspirations for house music, because this is the sort of music that was getting played before people like Jesse Saunders actually started making house music. So let's have a listen to it. Oh yeah, and that was one of the things I was going to say about it, is early house music was very rough and sort of poorly produced, and I think that was one of the things that people actually really gelled with and liked about it. I watched a documentary last night about the start of house music. I think it was a Channel 4 one. And they were talking about when Jesse Saunders made On and On, they heard that it was like so sort of low budget and crackly and cheap, and that inspired them and made them go, oh, we can do that. And so that's why everyone started making it.
It was more, it made that sort of sound of music more accessible, or that's like, you know, and less polished and less studio, you know, focused. And yeah, I think that's important. That's an important sort of situation in terms of the movement of people creating music. And even today, you know, that's sort of gone on, that's gone on through certain eras. Like grime, I would say, is an era that was sort of very DIY and low budget. I think I was listening to a podcast the other day, and they were talking about, you know, the whole grime thing where they were making music on PlayStation or something like that.
Yeah, Music 2000.
Yeah,
Music 2000. I used to love that, yeah.
Oh, I forgot about that game, yeah. Music 2000. So yeah, you know, it's not what you have, it's what you do with it, I think, is this sort of message within records like that. And
yeah, definitely, it's the feeling that matters, really, isn't it? It's not how polished it is.
Yeah.
So let's listen to the feeling of Colonel Abrams' Music is the Answer dub mix. So that was Colonel Abrams, Music is the Answer, a dub mix, and produced by Yvonne Turner, even though she's not credited. But yeah, that's one of the things I really love about that tune, maybe more so the original than the dub mix, is the lyrics is just sort of very repetitive. There's like a bunch of phrases that he just keeps repeating about like music is the answer, and just how it's like healing and whatever, but it's just like a repeated mantra, and I really like that in music. There's a lot of tunes that I really gel with that work really well on a dance floor, which are just like a repeated mantra about positivity. And I think one really significant one is Rudimental Waiting All Night, which you helpfully reminded me of the name of, which is just the same lyrics sung continuously, but the singer is incredible on that tune. And she just, you know, she changes the way she sings it, so it feels like an entire song, but it's just the same thing on repeat for the entire tune. And, you know, I think that was like, it was like big in the charts, wasn't it? It might have been number one.
Probably number one, I think.
Yeah. So like, you know, shows the power of a chanted mantra.
Hypnotizing people, yes, through exactly. Repetition.
Yeah.
And that's a formula that's worked not only with lyrics as well, with you know, especially in
the actual sound of music,
dance music. You know, you'd have these tracks that would just go on for 10 minutes and not much would change, but it would just be, you know, maybe a slight bit of percussion coming in and out, or, you know, just very hypnotic drum beats and loops forever and ever and ever.
Yeah, 100%. And like, you know, we're not doing much dancing right now. It's kind of difficult to, because this floor is a little bit bouncy, and if we move about too much, the records will skip. But we do love a dance, and that's one of the reasons why we're using the name Movers One, or Let's Dance Simultaneously.
Yeah, Let's Dance Simultaneously,
which is LDS. An acronym for LDS, exactly. That is about just people connecting to dance music, you know, connecting with dance music, just all moving together to a simultaneous beat, and there's nothing more repetitive than that.
Yeah, I think it just crosses all forms of dance, though. You know, we've been to, you know, multiple different types of events where dancing has taken place, and I think that's the sort of power in the moment of that sort of, you know, there's structure to music, you know, there is repetition of certain parts, and you know that plays a part in the emotion of what you feel in that moment, or how you behave.
A friend of mine was telling me actually the other day as well, I don't know how much truth there is in this, but I do trust her. She was telling me that she was looking into, it can be healing to do something that's repetitive, like a physical motion that's repetitive on both sides of your body, like running, for example. But she was talking about dancing, certain types of music encourages a very repetitive dance move. I think she'd been to a dub night.
I fully understand that. I've been to a few Channel One events over the last.
That's where she was.
Okay, yeah. Over the last course of the month, I didn't go to the one on Boxing Day, but I've been to a couple in the last month. They did their residency, and it was very much that. Actually, I came away from there feeling very energized and kind of almost a bit high. Actually,
yeah,
off of the bass and the repetitive motion of what I was doing.
You know? That is the power of moving as one.
Moving as one, yeah, and that was it. I think, you know, the people that were in there, you know, the energy, feeding off that energy, and the bass. I mean, the bass, when it hits you, it's like a full body massage. I took my friend and he said, yeah, I bought him a ticket, and he said, thanks for the full body massage afterwards, because those frequencies, they do go right through you.
I could do with some of that healing energy myself, to be honest, because I'm very bunged up at the moment. I've got a bit of a cold, which you can probably hear on the mic. I'll try not to sniffle down the mic too much, but yeah, I could do with some of that. So what you got for us next, Rory?
So this is a house record that I picked up, I think maybe last year I got it, and I heard it Jimster played with At Jazz at Royal Festival Hall, the Spirit Land, and as soon as I heard this record, I was just had it in my head. You know, it was one of those things. Again, it's a loop. It's a loop of this soul vocal. I think the original track, it comes from Detroit, and it is Los Hermanos presents Soul Saver, and the track is called Another Day, but it's been reissued on an Italian label, I believe. That's where I got it. I had to get it on Discogs from Italy. But yeah, it's a beautiful piece of music, and yeah, hope you enjoy it.
Let's have a listen.
Yeah. Thank you. So yes, that was Los Hermanos, Another Day.
Yeah, that was lovely. I really enjoyed that. The loopy sampling. You mentioned like some of the rough chops of this of the loops sort of adds to the vibe of it. It definitely does.
Yeah, I got a little bit obsessed with the hunt to get this one actually. I just couldn't get it out of my head. You know, one of those, you know, we were talking about that before, you know, the effectiveness of that hook. And that gospel vocal is just
it's nice.
Out of this world.
And this the sort of like the raw sort of sound to the recording of it as well is really, it's like kind of haunting. It's like, I need to hear this. Yeah, no, I like it. I like it a lot.
Yeah.
I'm going to go straight into the next one because it's kind of, it's a dub record that I picked up. Maybe UK dub, I'm not sure. It's from, I bought it at Lion Vibes, which is a sort of reggae and dub specialist, and they specialize a lot in UK dub in Brixton. I was working, so outside of DJing and LDS, I work as a filmmaker, videographer, and I was making a documentary about this record shop for Record Store Day. The lead up to Record Store Day 2022. And yeah, I had to buy something in there because all the tunes they were playing were great. So this is one of them, one of the ones I picked up. And we were speaking about like Channel One. It's very, it reminds me of the sort of stuff that Channel One play. It's by Yared Zedek featuring ABBA Original, and it's called Better Must Come. So let's get into it.
Thank you.
Very nice.
Yes, thank you. That was Better Must Come by Jared Zedek, featuring ABBA original.
I like the little illustration on this record.
Yeah, it's kind of like a little pencil drawing, isn't it?
Yeah.
Let's hold it up. Don't know if you can see that. Hope so. That's a banger. I really like my dub. I know you like your dub as well.
I do. I mean, I love a wide variety of things, as do you. But yeah, there's something about a big sound system with those bass frequencies.
Yeah, for sure. I think that's one of the reasons we're doing this this pre-recorded radio show / podcast thingamajig, is so that we can play a bit of everything that we're into and not just do like a DJ mix where it's like the same sort of thing all the way through. Just give us an opportunity to tell
some stories to each other as well as and to share some records with each other as well as you guys out there. I really love the sort of essence of collecting records, because I feel that personally anyway, and I think there's a lot of other people that share this opinion, that you know, each one has a story or has a, you know, you have a certain level of attachment to it, I guess, which brings up, you know, different time periods of your life. And yes, every record has a story. You know, every record that I have, I remember some specific place or time.
Yeah, definitely. It's not like a collection of WAVs or MP3s. I don't feel very connected to any of my digital files, but all of my records, I remember where I got them. And exactly, I think humans as well, we like physical things. We like to gather things up and go like, this is mine.
collect things.
Yeah, that's it. I'm a bit conflicted sometimes when it comes to records, because it is kind of like consumerism, and I try not to be too into that, but I just love them.
Well, so. I don't know. I mean, there's two arguments. I mean, there's two arguments for that. I mean, there's already so many records out there in the world, so I think, you know.
Yeah, true. You can make sure you stick to buying secondhand.
I mostly buy secondhand records. You know, occasionally I'll buy new ones, but mostly is what the majority of my collection are secondhand. So it's recycling, you know.
Yeah.
I'm a womble for a vinyl.
So what have you got next?
So the next one is, I guess it's quite a personal one to me, because it's a Kiwi band from New Zealand. They're quite popular, well known. Fat Freddy's Drop. My father is from New Zealand, and I spent some time living out there in my early 20s, which had a very strong impact on me and a lot of memories from that time. And yeah, so actually, funny story is we went. I've been to see Fat Freddy's Drop at Alexandra Palace here in London twice with my family, and again this summer. Actually, they did one out on the hill before the Kaleidoscope Festival, and it was amazing. So everyone was there in attendance, the whole family. And also another special thing is my brother bought this record for me. So family ties within it, and also the message in the song, I think, is fitting.
Nice. So, I think I've heard Fat Freddy's Drop live once at a Secret Garden party one of the years that we played there. They were also playing, and I managed to catch them. They're great. Yeah,
incredible live. You know, the records are amazing to listen to, but the live performance is, you know, they bring some different energy, because a lot of their tunes are quite slower numbers, but when they play live, it kind of starts off mellow, and then by the end of it, it's a full-blown rave. So I highly recommend it. Go and see that. But right, let's get into it.
For sure.
So this is Fat Freddy's Drop and Wandering Eye.
So good when I know you're skanking with me. Yeah. So good when I you're skanking. So good when you do. Yes, it feels so good when I know you're rocking with me. So good when I know you're rocking. So good when you do. Yes, it feels so good.
So good
when I know you're skanking with me. So good when I know you're skanking. So good when you do. Yes, it feels so good.
So good.
doing it for the love of music.
Yeah, two very good messages there. I think we're doing it for the love of music. We are. We have always been.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yes, that's a good segue actually into doing our outro. So we're going to play one more tune. Before we do that, we'll say our goodbyes and just say, you know, this is, as I said at the start, what we're doing in celebration of 12 years of LDS, the Movers One podcast radio thingamajig.
Something like that.
yeah. So we're going to do it once a month throughout 2023, basically, as part of our 12-year celebrations. It's going to be available on all the good podcasting platforms like Apple Podcasts, Spotify. We're going to put the video on YouTube if you're interested in watching the records turn around. The audio will also be on SoundCloud. So it's going to be everywhere. So I don't know where you're listening to this, but whichever one's most convenient to you, for you, just lock into it. And
yeah, and we'll be back next month with some more of this. I hope you've enjoyed it, and if you have, let us know in the comments or via our Instagram or wherever you can get hold of us, and that's at London Disco. We'd love to know and have your feedback on this first outing.
Yeah, it's very sort of slapdash makeshift. We're pretty much in my shed. And fortunately I've got some lights because that's what I do for a living, but I've maybe didn't set them up too great because it was light when we started outside and now it's dark. So, the lighting has probably changed throughout the course of the video, but
if you're listening to this on Spotify, it's not going to make any difference.
Yeah.
The lighting.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah,
so
if you're not keen on the lighting, just listen to it on a audio platform. But yeah, we're gonna get used to how to do this properly and improve it over the 12 months. So any little imperfections and flaws you've noted, let us know and we'll work on them.
Yeah, and thanks very much for tuning in.
Yes, and also outro tune is "Keep Your Pants On Cowboy" by Sar Havlicek. I hope I'm saying that right. I found this album recently on vinyl, but it's something I've been playing digitally since the very first start of LDS. It came out in 2012 and we started in 2011. So it's kind of going full circle playing one that we used to play quite regularly. So here is "Keep Your Pants On Cowboy"